Hi everyone, I hope you're having a good week so far. The text I would like to read for the message on this Wednesday is found in Luke's Gospel in chapter 22, and I want to read verses 14 through 20 there. And when the hour came, he reclined at the table, and the apostles with him. And he said to them, I have earnestly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat it until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God. And he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he said, Take this and divide it among yourselves. For I tell you that from now on I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes. And he took bread, And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And likewise the cup after they had eaten, saying, "This cup that is poured out for you is a new covenant in my blood. Given for you, poured out for you, do this in remembrance of me." One of the most amazing aspects in the way we are created is the way our mind is able to retain and recall memories. As we get older, we tend to become more forgetful. And yet at the same time, some memories from our childhood can suddenly pop up and we're amazed how long we had forgotten about this particular event. Happened to me just last week. I was out biking and after being on the road for a while, I went to an outlook area over the river valley, sat down on a bench. And as I was looking at the helmet lying next to me, I just realized how the shiny material looked so much like some rocks I used to pick up as a young boy. We went on vacation with my parents to Bavaria, and one day we were hiking through this beautiful forest, and we actually got right down into a brook, not very deep, and you were supposed to take your shoes off, and the water was really cold, but also refreshing on this warm day. And the kind of rocks you could find in that brook, they were so shiny. To us boys, it really looked like they were like jewels, and we really want to take as many of them home as possible. And I found it really neat to have a memory like that suddenly and unexpectedly come up. As a matter of fact, I find that with each new decade, memories of the past become more and more precious to me. They become a treasure that enables us to relive a moment in time afresh, making it present, not just visually, but also remembering what it felt like being there. Maybe even recall the aromas we smelled at the time and the good things we were tasting back then. I know my kids love to go through old photo albums, and thank God we still have those too, and not just some pictures stored on a computer or CD or memory card that may or may not still work. Of course, the pictures we browse through only make sense and hold special value for us in our family because of the people who've all been there. When we look at Amy's Germany trip with her class several years ago, we rely very much on her commentary, explaining what happened in each shot and what the experience was like for her. It is her memory, not ours in this case, and yet by watching and hearing the meaning, it now becomes a shared memory. Memories are deeply important. With every moment that passes, what just happened a second ago is technically no longer the present, is only accessible as a memory. Imagine if we couldn't remember anything at all. Just live from moment to moment, and then that experience would be gone forever. We would neither know who we are, nor know the reason why we're doing what we're doing. Our whole identity is wrapped up in remembering and knowing where we came from and what things have become meaningful and important to us personally. When Jesus celebrated the Jewish festival of Passover together with his disciples, he did not just remember God's gracious deliverance from Egypt, but also created a whole new memory with them in the way he broke the bread and shared the cup of wine. He infused Passover with a brand new meaning when he described his impending death as an atoning sacrifice on their behalf. And even though that death had not taken place yet, he's already talking about the specific eating of bread and drinking of wine as an act of remembrance. This would be the first and last time they shared this meal with him. But they would repeat it over and over again, almost daily later on in the life of the first church in Jerusalem, and then the other churches springing up ever since. We were not there almost 2,000 years ago, And yet through the written record of the Bible and the explanation of both Jesus and the apostle, it is now a shared memory of the church worldwide, across continents, and so many languages and cultures. It's really mind-blowing when you think about it. What exactly do we remember when we remember Jesus? How does the remembrance of his life and death and resurrection impact us today? Where do we have memories of our own biography, and yet the memory of Jesus intersects with them? Not randomly, but in a way that we are forever changed. I think the most important part of remembering Jesus is the assurance of both his love and forgiveness when he said those words, "Given for you." It's something we need to hear and receive every single day. How else are we going to face our own sinfulness and brokenness? And how else could we be sure that God accepts and welcomes us despite our past? And how else are we going to be able to let go of all the things that aren't a true reflection of our God-given identity and purpose? Jesus offered up the ultimate sacrifice, himself, and he said, "This is all for you." Enduring the pain, carrying the shame, taking away the curse of sin and death forever for us. It's no wonder that Paul would later write to the Corinthians in 1 Corinthians 2, verse 2, "For I resolved to know nothing while I was with you except Jesus Christ and him crucified." It's the one memory that is more important than all the others, because the cross of Jesus has redeeming value for the darker past, darker part of our past memories, and it empowers us to move forward with God rather than trying to master our life and circumstances without him. It even inspires us to live for him with the same joy and determination that he laid down his life for us. Therefore, remember Jesus. Remember his nails and crown of thorns. Remember the essence of the good news, where God says, "I'm for you, not against you, and I will be always with you." But I also want to reflect on the question that some may be struggling with. What about God's memories? How can it say in the Bible, on the one hand, that God remembers our sins no more? For example, in Isaiah 43, verse 25, or in Hebrews 8, verse 12. And yet there's also final judgment according to our deeds, where books are opened, not a single useless word spoken in our lifetime is forgotten. How do we reconcile those seemingly contradictory statements? I think the best illustration is Jesus' treatment of Simon Peter after his three denials and meeting him again after the events of the empty tomb. Not once is Jesus bringing up his past failures. There's neither shaming nor condemnation. Jesus knew how much Peter would fail before it happened, and he certainly had no memory lapse after the events either. But he's not bringing them back to mind, at least not in a destructive way. And I think we can expect the same. We can expect the same in the way God will treat our sins and failures. He's not wiping a memory drive clean, so to speak, in the sense that the data are lost, but he's taking what is dark and destructive and transforms it into something beautiful and empowering. Again, to quote the Apostle Paul, "But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace to me was not without effect." 1 Corinthians 15, verse 10. So God has not forgotten, but he deliberately chooses to never bring up these sins again in a way that we would have to dread or fear. We're cleansed, we're redeemed, we're being given Jesus' own righteousness. And that is such a huge reason to be thankful and rejoice. It lifts such a heavy burden from us, and it also frees us from a mindset that is all about not trying to miss out on life by filling it all with junk that has no lasting value at all. When we remember Jesus this way, we're being neither nostalgic nor stuck in the past. What we're actually doing is renewing our minds by remembering what is true, in contrast to the many lies that are propagated in the world and the lies we often tell ourselves. It also exposes the lies we may have been believing about God when the devil whispered in our ear, "He could never love you. Just look how filthy and selfish and unworthy you are. The world would be better off without you." It is then that you can and need to remember, "Oh no, He loves me more than anything, and He'll never stop loving me. I'm adopted, I'm forgiven, I'm a child of the King." So may you all take that truth and assurance with you and keep remembering Jesus, especially when you start to feel down or hopeless during this strange time, seemingly endlessly confined to the same space. Let Jesus shed new light on your past, your future, and this very moment right now, because He is here right now. You may just have forgotten how present and good and powerful He is. Let's pray. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for the truth of You coming into this world and giving Your own life for us. Thank you, Lord, for the ability to remember the kind of things that You did and said, and that are just as true today as they have always been. Lord, forgive our forgetfulness. Forgive us, Lord, where we simply ignored Your sacrifice and where we've been distracted by so many other things in this world. I pray, Lord, that You will help us today to renew our minds and especially to think back to these words that You already said to Your own disciples, that Your body was broken for us and that Your blood was shed on our behalf. Pray, Lord, that we will take comfort in knowing that we've been forgiven and justified, and that You also continue to take care of Your children. Pray, Lord, that You may continue to help us have wisdom in how to spend our time each day, as it's difficult to break out of the just dreadfulness of always being in the same space. Just pray, Lord, that You continue to also to bless our families as they sometimes struggle with children dealing with this difficulty or tensions that arise in the home, but also those who may be all by themselves and very lonely. May You be very present with them, and that they will simply experience in a tangible way that they are not abandoned. And Lord, whatever may still be on our minds, we simply want to include them in the words that You have taught us to pray. So let's pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be Thy name. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For Thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you.